Hello students, welcome back to the economics class of plus 2 standard. Today we will start with lesson number 11, problems of deficient demand and excess demand. In this chapter you will learn about problems of deficient demand, its meaning, graphical representation, causes and consequences of deficient demand. In the problems of excess demand you will learn about the meaning, graphical representation, causes and consequences of excess demand. Under the remedial measures, you will learn about the measures to correct the deficient demand and measures to correct the excess demand. So today we will start with the topic problems of deficient demand, meaning, graphical representation, causes and consequences. And the problems of excess demand, its meaning, graphical representation, causes and consequences of excess demand. So let's start with the important key terms related to this topic. First one is full employment, disposable income, aggregate demand, aggregate supply, excess demand and deficient demand. First is full employment level. Full employment level means when all the resources, whether water, coal, petroleum, oil and labors, machines, whatever resources are there that are properly utilized without any wastage, that is known as full employment level. So when 100 workers are living in any region and get the job opportunity also, no one is unemployed, it means that there is full employment level prevails. In the same way, if in any industry there is having two machines and all the machines are working at their full capacity, no machine is lying idle, this is known as full employment level. So full employment level means when all the productive resources like land, labor and capital of a country are fully employed in the production system. This can be considered as a full employment level, means with a zero wastage of resources. Disposable income. Suppose my gross annual income, it is rupees 10,000 and I have to pay the taxes and other deductions. So after the deduction of rupees 2,000 in the form of income tax, wealth tax and other deductions like fines, penalty, forfeitures, licensing fee, registration fee, etc., I will get the personal disposable income, that is gross annual income 10,000 minus all the taxes and other kinds of deduction, that is 2,000. What is left with me, that is 8,000. So this 8,000 is my disposable income. So personal disposable income is a part of personal income which belongs to the households. They may decide to consume a part of it and save the rest. It reflects the purchasing power of the household. With the more disposable income and lesser taxes, it means that our purchasing power, it is more, we can consume more. Next one is aggregate demand. Suppose in the year 2019, I am having a demand for the full year, that is services of engineers, carpenters, teacher and the commodities like dresses, cosmetics, spices, food grains and pair of shoes. This is my aggregate demand for the year 2019. And in order to satisfy the wants for these goods and services, I have to incur the expenditure worth rupees 8,000. So that is my aggregate expenditure. Let's understand the aggregate demand with the help of a table. Suppose in an economy, there are different people demanding for the different commodities. I have taken the commodities like jeans, shirts, car and oil. And different people will demand the different commodities in different quantities also. And in order to satisfy their demands, they will incur the expenditure on these goods and services. So the total expenditure in the economy for the aggregate demand, it is rupees 35,000. So aggregate demand is the total demand for all the goods and services in an economy. And the expenditure incurred on the purchase of these goods and services, it is measured in the form of money during a year. That is known as aggregate expenditure during a year. Next one is aggregate supply. Aggregate supply means whatever goods and services are produced in the economy like services of a doctor, services of engineer, teacher, cobbler, barber, and many other services are there, like banking services are also there, chartered accountants are also there. So the supply of all these services plus goods like production of footballs, production of watches, timepiece, production of vegetables, fruits, production of tractors, cars, all these goods plus services, that is known as the aggregate supply. And when the production of these goods and services are valued in terms of money, then the nation will earn the national income, that is known as aggregate supply. So aggregate supply is the total output of goods and services in an economy whose value measured in the form of money during a year. And when we will measure the output in the form of money of aggregate supply, that is known as aggregate income during a year. Excess demand. See, here in the picture you can see there are 8 kids and we are having candies 6. So 2 candies are less, or you can say that 2 kids are more and candies are less. In this way you can say that there is a excess demand for 2 candies. Suppose in an economy there is a demand for 100 laborers and the supply of laborers is 80. This is known as excess demand, because supply for 20 laborers it is less. In this way, demand for labor is more than the supply of labor. So excess demand means when aggregate demand exceeds aggregate supply for goods and services in the economy at full employment level. Deficient demand. Deficient demand means when supply it is more and demand it is less. Suppose in an economy there is a demand for 100 workers and the supply of workers it is 120. So it means that 20 workers are unemployed in the economy. So deficient demand refers to a situation wherein aggregate demand in the economy falls short of aggregate supply of the goods and services at full employment level. Now we will discuss the deficient demand with the help of a graph. You know that deficient demand means that supply it is more and demand it is less for any goods and services. Suppose the level of income it varies from 0 till 600 and the consumption expenditure increases with the increase in the level of income. Investment expenditure that remains the same at all levels of income. Now aggregate demand is the summation of the two components, that is consumption and income. That is 100 plus 100 will give you 200, 150 plus 100 will give you 250. In this way you can calculate the aggregate demand. Now savings can be calculated from income and consumption. 0 minus 100 will give you minus 100, 100 minus 150 will give you minus 50, 200 minus 0 will give you 200 minus 200 will give you 0. In this way you can calculate the savings. Now aggregate supply can be calculated from the two components, that is consumption and saving. 100 minus 100 will give you 0, 150 minus 50 will give you 100, 200 minus 0 will give you 200. In this way you can calculate the aggregate supply. So aggregate supply is the total output of all the goods and services when termed in the form of money. When the value of all these goods and services, it is expressed in the terms of money, that is known as national income. That's why the figures in the national income and the aggregate supply remains the same. Now on the x-axis, we will measure income and employment. And on the y-axis, we will measure consumption, investment and saving. First of all, we will draw the aggregate supply curve. At zero level of income, there is zero supply. At 100 level of income, there is 100 aggregate supply. 200 level of income, 200 aggregate supply. 300 level of income, 300 aggregate supply. And you will get a curve, upward sloping aggregate supply curve, starting from the zero, making an angle of 45 degree, showing that aggregate supply कैन बी लेस देन एग्रीगेट डिमांड और इक्वल्स टू एग्रीगेट डिमांड और मोर देन एग्रीगेट डिमांड. नाउ नेक्स्ट वन इज एग्रीगेट डिमांड. इट इज एट जीरो लेवल ऑफ इनकम देयर इज 200 एग्रीगेट डिमांड, दैट इज द ऑटोनोमस कंजम्पशन. एट 100 लेवल ऑफ इनकम देयर इज 250 एग्रीगेट डिमांड. एंड इन दिस वे यू कैन मार्क द अदर पॉइंट्स एंड यू कैन गेट द एग्रीगेट डिमांड कर्व पॉजिटिवली स्लोप्ड स्टार्टिंग फ्रॉम द वाई इंटरसेप्ट. एज यू कैन सी दैट एग्रीगेट डिमांड एंड एग्रीगेट सप्लाई इंटरसेक्ट विद ईच अदर एट पॉइंट ई. दिस पॉइंट ई शोज द अंडर यूटिलाइजेशन ऑफ रिसोर्सेज. बिकॉज वाई अंडर यूटिलाइजेशन ऑफ रिसोर्सेज इट इज शोइंग बिकॉज टोटल एग्रीगेट सप्लाई इन द इकोनॉमी दैट इज एट पॉइंट टी एंड द लेवल ऑफ इनकम एंड एम्प्लॉयमेंट इट इज ओ एस. मीन्स एट ओ एस लेवल ऑफ इनकम द टोटल सप्लाई इन द इकोनॉमी इट इज एस टी वाइल द टोटल डिमांड इट इज एस यू. सो टी यू इट इज यस डेफिशियंट डिमांड और द डिफ्लेशनरी गैप. मीन्स एग्रीगेट सप्लाई इज मोर एंड एग्रीगेट डिमांड इट इज लेस. एग्रीगेट डिमांड फॉल्स शॉर्ट ऑफ एग्रीगेट सप्लाई एट फुल एम्प्लॉयमेंट लेवल. इक्विलिब्रियम लेवल ऑफ इनकम एंड एम्प्लॉयमेंट इज ओ आर. इक्विलिब्रियम लेवल इज हेयर बट द फुल एम्प्लॉयमेंट लेवल इज एट पॉइंट टी. सो फुल एम्प्लॉयमेंट लेवल इज ओ एस लेवल ऑफ इनकम एंड एम्प्लॉयमेंट. एट ओ एस लेवल ऑफ इनकम एग्रीगेट डिमांड इट इज इक्वल्स टू एस यू एंड एग्रीगेट सप्लाई इट इज इक्वल्स टू एस टी. सो एस टी माइनस एस यू विल गिव यू टी यू. दिस टी यू इट इज योर डेफिशिएंट डिमांड और डिफ्लेशनरी गैप. नाउ दिस सिचुएशन ऑफ डेफिशिएंट डिमांड इट इज ऑल्सो नोन एज डिफ्लेशनरी गैप. कॉजेज ऑफ डेफिशिएंट डिमांड फॉल इन द लेवल्स ऑफ कंजम्पशन एंड इन्वेस्टमेंट. वेन द प्राइवेट सेक्टर कट इन द कंजम्पशन एक्सपेंडिचर एंड इन्वेस्टमेंट एक्सपेंडिचर द इकोनॉमी विल हार्म इन दिस वे. बिकॉज वेन द एंटरप्रेन्योर विल नॉट इन्वेस्ट इन द फर्म्स ड्यूरिंग द ड्यू टू द पुअर बिजनेस कंडीशंस वट विल हैपन. देयर इज कट इन द एम्प्लॉयमेंट लेवल. विद द कट इन द एम्प्लॉयमेंट लेवल इनकम एंड आउटपुट लेवल विल ऑल्सो बी डाउन. ड्यू टू विच लेसर इनकम इन द हैंड्स ऑफ द हाउस होल्ड एंड हाउस होल्ड विद द लेसर इनकम विल सेव मोर एंड कंज्यूम लेस. सो लाइक द कंजम्पशन एक्सपेंडिचर एनी रिडक्शन इन द इन्वेस्टमेंट विल रिड्यूस द लेवल ऑफ एग्रीगेट डिमांड. पॉलिसी ऑफ क्रेडिट कॉन्ट्रैक्शन. वेन द सेंट्रल बैंक अडॉप्ट द पॉलिसी ऑफ क्रेडिट कॉन्ट्रैक्शन बाय इंक्रीजिंग द इंटरेस्ट रेट्स ऑन द लैंडिंग्स. इन दैट केस इफ द कॉमर्शियल बैंक्स विल बोरो फ्रॉम द सेंट्रल बैंक्स वट हैपन. द सेंट्रल बैंक फॉर द क्रेडिट क्रिएशन इन द इकोनॉमी विल सेट हाई इंटरेस्ट रेट्स for the lendings to the commercial banks and the commercial bank will also decide to charge higher rate of interest for the lendings to the borrowers. This would result in a fall in money supply because the entrepreneurs or the households are reluctant to borrow from the banks at a high rate of interest. So with the lesser money supply there would be a lesser expenditure, lesser investment, lesser employment and output and the lower income level it is prevail in the economy. So with the lower incomes the household will consume less and save more. Causes of deficient demand. Cut in the government expenditure. The another cause for the deficient demand is cut in the government expenditure. That when the government will not do any expenditure for making of or the building of roads, dams, bridges, flyovers and subsidies. Or the government adopt the disinvestment policy. Disinvestment policy means when the government sells their assets in the hands of the private sector. So what happens with this? With the government cut in the government expenditure and due to the disinvestment policy, there is lesser employment opportunities in the economy and cut in the level of output and income also. Again with the lesser income, the household will save more and consume less and this will adversely affect the aggregate demand. Next one is rising taxes. If the government raises the existing tax rate, that is income tax or wealth tax, there would be a fall in the disposable income with the people. and the prices of goods and services will also go up due to higher cost of production. Because no subsidy it is given by the government for the raw material, for the electricity to the firms, and laborers are also asking for the higher wages. So in this way, cost of production will be higher, and in order to increase the profits, entrepreneur will set the prices of goods and services at a higher rates. And the people will now spend less on the consumer goods in order to save more money. Fall in the export demand. Suppose the Fulkari embroidery in India, it is costlier. Due to its cost, in the foreign countries, its demand will be lesser. So the situation of deficient demand may arise when the demand for domestic goods abroad fall due to the high domestic prices. Consequences of deficient demand. When aggregate demand is less than aggregate supply, the producers will have unplanned or undesired build-up of inventories of unsold goods. Means when aggregate demand it is lesser due to cutting the government expenditure or due to higher interest rates, what happens? The consumer will save more and consumes less. So due to this reason, the entrepreneurs are left with the unsold inventories of goods. So what will happen then? The producers or the entrepreneurs will decide to cut in the production in the next production cycle, and this will reduce the economy's output and income and spread the unemployment in the economy and creates a deflationary situation in the economy. So fall in the level of output leads to a fall in the level of employment, which in turn reduces the level of income. Fall in the income further reduces the aggregate demand, as consumer wants to save more with the lesser income and consumes less. So the overall impact on the deficient demand is that the economy attains underemployment equilibrium. Next one is excess demand. On the behalf of the same table, now we will discuss the excess demand. As you know that income level varies from 0 till 600, and the consumption expenditure increase with the increase in the level of income. Investment expenditure, it remains the same at all levels of income, and aggregate demand, it is increased with the increase in the income level. It is the summation of the two components, that is consumption and investment. 100 plus 100, 200. 150 plus 100, 250, and the saving we can calculate from the income and the consumption. 0 minus 100 will give you minus 100, 100 minus 150 will give you minus 50. In this way, you can calculate the savings. And the aggregate supply, it is the summation of the two components, that is consumption and saving. Consumption, it is 100 minus 100, it is 0 aggregate supply. 150 minus 50 will give you the 100 aggregate supply. In this way, you can calculate the aggregate supply. As you know that the values of aggregate supply and the income level remains the same. This is due to the reason that aggregate supply means that total production in the economy within a particular year at a particular price level. And when the output it is measured, or the value of the output it is measured in terms of money, we will get the income. And that remains the same as the aggregate supply. So aggregate supply is nothing but it is the income. Now we will draw and understand the excess demand on the graph. On the x-axis, we will measure income and employment. On the y-axis, we will measure consumption and investment and savings. When the income level was 100, aggregate supply was also 100. 200 level of income, aggregate supply 200. And after joining all the points, you will get an upward sloping aggregate supply curve starting from 0. Making an angle of 45 degree, which shows that aggregate supply can be less than aggregate demand, can be equals to aggregate demand, or can be more than aggregate demand. Now, aggregate demand at 0 level of income, there is 200 aggregate demand. At 100 level of income, there is 250 aggregate demand. At 200 level of income, there is 300 aggregate demand. And after joining the points, you will get an upward sloping line aggregate demand, showing that it starts from y-intercept and it is intersecting with aggregate supply curve at point E. But the actual demand or the current demand, it is at point E. So this shows that there is a inflationary gap or the excess demand in the economy. Supply it is lesser. At this point, all the resources are fully utilized. And what happened at the full employment level, still aggregate demand, it is more than the aggregate supply. At OY1 level of income and employment, aggregate demand and aggregate supply intersect with each other. This is the full employment level or the equilibrium level at the full employment. But the current demand, it is at point E. So EY, it is the total demand which is greater than the aggregate supply, that is OY1. And thus the difference between AE1, it is equals to AY1 minus Y1E1. This is your excess demand or deflationary gap. Excess demand means that aggregate demand, it is more than aggregate supply. See, the aggregate supply is here and aggregate demand, it is here. Economy attains full employment equilibrium level at a higher prices only. Now next one is causes of excess demand. There may be an increase in the private investment because of increase in credit facilities. Now increase in the credit facilities to the private sector means that private sector getting the subsidies on the raw material from the government, or you can say that they can borrow from the banks at a cheaper rate of interest. Excess demand may be caused by an increase in the money supply due to deficit financing. Deficit financing means when the government, in the case of financial crisis, issue a new currency. It may be caused by increase in consumption demand due to rise in the propensity to consume or fall in the propensity to save. It means that with the increased income, whether due to increase in the government expenditure or cut in the rate of interest, our additional consumption will also increase due to the increase in the additional income, or you can say that additional savings will fall. The situation of excess demand may also arise when demand for exports increases due to lower domestic prices as compared to the international prices. Like India will import oil from those countries from where it can get the profit, or it can get the oils at a cheaper rates. Increase in disposable income due to fall in the tax rates. When the tax is imposed on the income, it is lesser, then the disposable income in the hands of the household will be more. Now, consequences of excess demand. Excess demand creates inflationary pressure in the economy. Inflationary pressure in the economy means that with the passage of time, what happened, the prices of the same commodity will increase, and the depreciation in money, it is there. Depreciation means there is a fall in the value of money. In that case, excess demand arises. But when excess demand, it is there after the full employment, then there is no scope of increase in the output level. Means if I am having 10 pence, I have used all the 10 pence and still I want to write something, but I can't write because of no pens with me. So this is known as excess demand. Now what will happen in order to control the demand or excess demand? What the economy will do? Economy will set the higher prices for the commodity that is having a excess demand. Now inflationary pressure is built up in the economy because beyond full employment level, flow of goods and services cannot increase to meet this excess demand. In the economy, 10 pence were there. I have used all the 10 pence. Now there is no scope of increasing the production of pence. Now excess demand does not lead to increase the level of output. It only puts the pressure on the available aggregate supply, and that aggregate supply or the output will causes higher prices. entrepreneur will set the higher prices for the available output. So rising prices further cause a increase in the cost of production in the form of wages, rent, done. So consequently the price tend to rise still higher. In case of excess demand, economy stays at full employment equilibrium level but at a higher price level. Now difference between deficient demand and excess demand. Deficient demand indicates the deficiency in aggregate demand as compared to the aggregate supply. While in excess demand, aggregate demand is more than the aggregate supply. In the deficient demand pushes the economy to the underemployment equilibrium. While in the excess demand, excess demand forces the economy to achieve the equilibrium level at a higher prices, but the income or the output remaining the same. Under the deficient demand, it generates the deflationary gap. Deflationary gap means that deficiency in aggregate demand as compared to the aggregate supply. Means aggregate supply it is more and aggregate demand it is less. In the excess demand, it generates inflationary gap. Inflationary gap means when there is lesser aggregate supply and more aggregate demand. Next one is deficient demand causes a fall in the level of output and employment, and in the excess demand does not result in an increase in the level of output and employment. It indicates a situation of underemployment, only causes to rise in prices, indicate a situation after full employment at higher price level. So students, today you have covered the topics, key terms like aggregate demand, aggregate supply, full employment, deficient demand, excess demand, disposable income, and the problems of deficient demand, meaning of deficient demand, its graphical representation, causes and consequences. Problems of excess demand, its meaning, graphical representation, causes and consequences. Hope you all have understood the topic. Now it's time to note down the homework. Question number 1 is define the following terms with examples: aggregate demand, aggregate supply, full employment, deficient demand, excess demand and disposable income. Second question is graphically explain the meaning of excess demand, also discuss the causes and consequences of excess demand. Graphically explain the meaning of deficient demand and discuss the causes and consequences of deficient demand. Next one is differentiate between deficient demand and excess demand. And students, please go through the links for more clarity. Thank you for listening.